Making of a soldier. Ever since I was 4 years old, I felt fear whenever I saw anyone wearing a green uniform. From the time my family and I crossed the United States-Mexican border, crawling underneath a barbed wire fence that separated the two countries, our father warned us that we had to hide from La Migra, the border patrol guards dressed in green uniforms. If they catch you, you'll be deported back to Mexico, he said repeatedly. We managed to evade the green uniformed men for 10 years, but they ultimately caught and deported us when I was in the 8th grade. And even though we came back legally, I continued to feel apprehensive every time I saw a green uniform. And now, I had to wear one once a week during my entire freshman and sophomore years. I had no choice. Like many land-grant colleges, Santa Clara required all undergraduates to take the 2-year Basic Military Science Program, Reserve Officers Training Corps. The 1.5-unit courses consisted of 2 hours of lecture and 1 hour of drills. Every Tuesday morning, we dressed in our Army uniform and marched in Buckshaw Stadium on the east side of the campus. The night before, my classmates and I spent hours getting ready for our Tuesday morning ritual. I know how much you like doing this, Smokey teased me, taking out his Army uniform from the closet and gently laying it on his bed lengthwise. I ignored him and continued doing the reading for my Western Civilization class. From the corner of my eye, I saw him pressing his trousers with the palm of his hands, trying to get rid of the wire hanger crease marks. I put down my textbook. You can iron mine when you're finished with yours, I said. Deal, if you spit shine my shoes. We both laughed. I took out my uniform, hung it on the doorknob, and brushed off the lint with my hands. It's easier and faster if you use Scotch tape, Smokey said. He took out a roll of tape from his desk drawer, cut off a strip, and holding both ends, passed it over his uniform. You're a genius. You'll be promoted to general in no time. Just follow my orders, he said, and I'll make you a good soldier yet. Yes, sir. I saluted him and clicked my heels. Smokey left to get a haircut from Ernie De Gasparis, my only classmate from Santa Maria High School. Ernie had set up shop in his room on the 3rd floor of Kenna Hall and cut hair free of charge for his friends. I continued getting ready to pass military inspection on Tuesday. Using an old sock and brass solution, I polished the clip belt buckle, the 2 small round insignias that were pinned to each side of the jacket lapel, and the insignia of the American Eagle pinned to the front of the cap. To polish the black leather low-quarter shoes, I spit on them and furiously rubbed them with a small cotton ball until they shined like glass. I had just finished polishing the 2nd shoe when Smokey returned, sporting a crew cut. Ernie's ready for you, he said. It's time to get rid of your hair hat. Unlike my classmates, I had long hair with an elevated wave at the front. I hated getting it cut, but the choice was not mine. As cadets, we were expected to conform to uniform grooming standards. And we did. On Tuesday morning, every freshman and sophomore male dressed alike and wore a black plastic nameplate on the right breast pocket flap. As we crossed the campus on our way to Buckshaw Stadium, Santa Clara looked more like a military camp than a university. We reported to the field house, where each one of us was handed an M16 infantry rifle that was about 20 inches long and weighed about 7 pounds. We were informed by Captain Glasson that during ROTC activities, cadre and cadets of senior rank were to be addressed by rank and name, and that in the chain of command, each one of us would be addressed as cadet and name. We were to use the term sir and salute when conversing with or replying to a cadet officer or officer of higher rank. These rules and discipline reminded me of my father, who demanded that we obey him at all times and not question his authority. We were then grouped in platoons and lined up in rectangular formation. A senior rank cadet went up and down inspecting each one of us, making sure we had everything in order. Brass and shoes shined, crew haircut, and clean shave. If anything was out of compliance, we got demerits, which affected our grade. After inspection, we jogged in place for 1 to 2 minutes, counting cadence and carrying our M16 rifles as we marched, following orders. Attention, lift, march, left face, right face, count off, double time. At times when I got confused and did a left face instead of a right face, I heard the senior cadet holler, "Pay attention, cadet." "Yes, sir," I shouted back automatically, thinking how silly and what a waste of time these drills were. In the afternoon, we attended lectures given by Captain Glasson or Colonel O'Brien on American military history and map reading, which I enjoyed because I liked learning about the past. But I still disliked wearing the Army uniform and going to drill. Eventually, though, having to wear it stripped me of my dread of men dressed in green uniforms. More important, it pleased my father. When I gave him a picture of me in uniform a few months later, over Christmas break, he said, "I am proud of you, mijo. You can make something of yourself in the Army when you're poor." A compromise. Smokey and I got along well, except when it came to sports. He read the sports section of the newspaper thoroughly and faithfully every day of the week and had heated debates with Pat Hall, Jim Broadlow, and Tony Lizza, our next-door neighbors, about what teams and players were the best. The debates often turned to yelling matches, each stubbornly defending his opinion as if his life depended on it. Sports were like a foreign language to me. Whenever these matches took place, I would pick up my books and run off to Varsity Library or take a leisurely walk in the Mission Gardens. My indifference to sports troubled Smokey, but what really upset him was my absence at Santa Clara games. He often tried to convert me into a sports fan, but I resisted like a mule. One of those times was Friday night, the second week of November, a few days before Thanksgiving break. We had just gone through mid-semester exams, and I felt tired and tense. "You don't have any school spirit," Smokey complained. "Don't you care about our Santa Clara teams? Why don't you support them? Do you care at all?" "I do care, but I came here to learn, not to attend games." "You can do both. You need balance in your life." "You're right. It's my life," I shot back. "So let me live my life. You live yours." "I'm tired of having the same argument over and over. Why don't you leave me alone?" I had never spoken so harshly to him. Smokey was stunned. He stared at me as though I had grown 3 heads. I was as surprised as he was. We had had this disagreement before, but I had never lost my temper. At home, I had learned to control my emotions, especially in front of my father. My hands trembled and my face felt as though it were on fire. We stood facing each other in dead silence. I could see in Smokey's face that I had hurt him. His eyes looked like those of a wounded deer. He shook his head and sat on the edge of his bed. "I'm sorry, Smokey," I said, after calming down a bit. He looked up and said, "Because you're my roommate and I care about you," he said. "That's why I won't leave you alone. I want you to enjoy life, to have fun." His tenderness and honesty calmed me down completely. He sounded like my older brother, who always looked out for me. I missed Roberto more than ever at that moment. "I'm really, really sorry, Smokey," I repeated, struggling to find the right words to tell him how bad I felt. "It's okay." He stood up and adjusted his cap. His tall, lanky body towered over mine. "Look, let's compromise. You like dancing, I like sports. You come with us to the Santa Clara St. Mary's basketball game tonight, and I'll join you at a dance next weekend. Deal?" "Let me think about it," I said, glancing at the pile of books on my desk. "It's going to be a great game. He tilted his head to the side and raised his eyebrows. We just went through midterm exams. Let's treat ourselves. Come on. Okay, deal. Great. Now all we need is a way to get there. Isn't the game here? I asked. Traveling took time. It's downtown in the San Jose Civic Center. We'll ask Tom Mulhart for a ride. He never misses a game. Early that evening, Tom, Tony Lizza, Pat Hall, Smokey, and I piled into Tom's white Volvo and drove to the game. It was one of the few basketball games I had ever attended. The old Spanish-style auditorium was in the north end of the city, about 4 miles from Santa Clara. The main entrance was jammed with students who pushed their way in. We squeezed our way through and managed to find seats on the Santa Clara side facing St. Mary's students, who sat on the opposite side of the auditorium. They rooted for the Irish Warriors. We cheered for the Broncos. As both teams came onto the court, the noise from the stands grew louder and the stomping of feet made the bleachers shake. It felt like an earthquake. Both teams played well, but at the end, the Broncos conquered the Irish Warriors. All of us, even I, left the game feeling excited, full of energy, and proud. As we drove back to campus, my classmates continued cheering. Let's celebrate, Smokey said. Why don't we stop by a liquor store and get some beer? Are you crazy? Tom said, slowing the car down. We're not 21. So? I'm sure all of us have drunk before, Smokey responded. Or did you mean who's going to buy it? I haven't drunk before, I said. You gotta be kidding, Smokey exclaimed. Don't tell me you're... I am not joking, I said, interrupting him. My father would never allow it. They all laughed, but I had not meant it as a joke. Okay, well, it's time you did, Smokey said. Tony volunteered to get the beer. Tom pulled up to a corner liquor store that had iron bars on its two small front windows. Tony got out and waited outside for a potential customer. As one approached, Tony stopped him, exchanged a few words, and handed him money. The man nodded his head in approval and went inside. A few minutes later, he came out carrying two large brown bags and handed one of them to Tony. Tony rushed back to the car, looking all around like a fugitive. Mission accomplished, he said, sliding onto the front seat and passing the bag to Smokey in the back seat. Tom parked the car near a dark, empty lot on Alviso Street, a few blocks away from campus. Smokey handed each one of us a can of beer and passed around the beer can opener. I wanted to belong, and I wanted to see what drinking was like and to make it up to Smokey for having yelled at him. But I felt nervous. Here's to the Broncos, Pat said, raising his can. To the Broncos, we all repeated, taking a drink. The beer had a skunky smell and tasted like cardboard. I held my breath and gulped it down. I don't feel anything, I thought. We quickly had another round. I guzzled the second can. Suddenly, I began to feel lightheaded and giddy. I laughed at everything my classmates said, even though I did not understand everything they were talking about. As time wore on, my giddiness turned to sadness. I started thinking about Tiger Town, a rough neighborhood in Santa Maria where I had clean windows. It had run-down bars and liquor stores that stretched for several blocks on both sides of Main Street. The sidewalks were littered with cigarette butts, crushed cigarette packs, and broken beer bottles. I had to scrub the windows extra hard to loosen the globs of dried spit glued to the glass. Mexican music blasted through the front doors of the bars, and a rancid odor filled the air. I liked the music, but the men inside made me sad. Some were braceros, temporary farm workers from Mexico, who came to Tiger Town from the local labor camp on Sunday afternoons when work was scarce. They sat at the bar listening to ranchera music playing on the jukebox and drinking beer and staring into the mirror behind the counter. They were all far away from their families in Mexico, just as I now felt far away from my family in Santa Maria. I started to cry. Hey, what's wrong? Smokey asked. You start out as a happy and silly drunk, and now you turn into a crying drunk. The only recollection I have after that is holding on to Smokey and Pat as we walked back to the dorm before our curfew at 1 o'clock in the morning. I plopped onto my bed, dizzy and sleepy. That night, I dreamed I was washing the front windows of a bar in Tigertown. In the dream, the clear sky suddenly darkens like a black curtain. There's thunder and lightning and torrential rain. My bucket quickly fills with water, overflows and spills into the entrance of the bar. The water slowly grows and gains strength until it turns into a rapid and forceful stream, carrying me away, encircled by beer bottles and cans, and dumps me into the Santa Maria River. As I struggle to keep my head above the murky water, I spot a woman dressed in white with long, flowing black hair. She glides along the riverbank, reaching out to save me. I desperately try to grab her hand, but she disappears. I woke up in a cold sweat. For a few seconds, I did not know where I was. My heart was pounding and my head felt like it was in a vice. I took 4 aspirins and crawled back into bed. Then I remembered what had happened the night before and felt ashamed.